Knowledge defines leadership. Some leaders derive respect from the team purely by their knowledge. The more knowledgeable a leader is, the more likelihood of attracting respect as a leader. Today, as part of leadership series by Global TV, we have one such leader who is an epitome of knowledge in the areas of electoral studies, federalism, political process, and institutions. Dr. Sandeep Shastri, welcome to our discussions on leadership.
Thank you, Tom.
Dr. Shastri is currently the Vice Chancellor of Jagran Lakes University, Bhopal. He was Pro Vice Chancellor, Jain University, Bangalore, Director of Research and Training Wing of Jain Group of Institutions. He was a faculty in the Political Science Department of Bangalore University, Co-Chair of the Research Committee, International Political Science Association, National Coordinator of Lok Nidhi Network. Dr. Shastri has authored 13 books, hundreds of articles in reputed publications across the globe. He's a political commentator who is regularly on National Television Network. He has been a consultant with the UNDP and the World Bank. In his own words, he is a teacher by instinct, researcher by choice, trainer by passion, and a lifelong learner. Thank you, Dr. Shastri, once again for joining us today.
My pleasure.
I'm sure your words of wisdom on leadership will help our listeners. Some leaders show leadership qualities from a very early age. Some build it up as they grow in their career or profession. What has been your experience? You showed some leadership qualities at an early age, or you built it up as you grew in the organizations?
This is a great discussion forum that you all have created. Now, in response to your question, sometimes today also I raise a question in my mind as to whether I qualify to be a leader or whether I have the advantage of wonderful people around me who work with me. So for me, leadership is not about a position or a responsibility or a years of experience. It is about an ecosystem that you work in and the blessing you have of wonderful people around you from whom you learn. If by chance some people feel that they have been influenced or inspired by what is said and done, that is my good fortune based on my experience. Tom, often make this point, that in the last 40 years, more than 30,000 students have allowed me to learn with them in their class. Have that image that I have taught anybody, because I don't think you can teach anybody. You can only create an environment in which everybody learns together. So my approach whenever I have been given a position of responsibility is to A, understand that responsibility, and B, try to see that the team that I have with me develops that trust in me, that there is something that they can gain in terms of experience and knowledge from me. And similarly, I look to my entire team to be able to take those tasks forward. So trust and allowing people to take ownership have been the two principles that I have followed whenever I have been given responsibilities in organizations.
Okay. Just to... just as part of my question, when you were in school or college, did you occupy any positions where you were called a leader?
I had my high school in a central school, but run by an Indian embassy, because at that point of time, my father was posted in Kabul, Afghanistan. This was 1972 to 1977. And this was the time I did my 8th grade, 9th grade, 10th grade, and 11th grade. And I was lucky because my class was always the second senior most class in school. When I was in 8th standard, 9th was the senior most. So for 4 years, I happened to be in the second senior most batch, 3 years second senior most batch and 1 year senior most batch. Result was, in school, we had what was called a school parliament.
Right.
In which there was a prime minister, leader of the opposition. The prime minister invariably became the head boy or the head girl. So that was the system we had.
Right.
So in my 8th grade, I became the leader of the opposition.
Okay.
In the 9th, I became the prime minister and the head boy.
Okay.
In the 10th, again, I became the leader of the opposition. And in 11th, again, I became the prime minister and head boy. So I had the advantage of looking at responsibility from both the perspectives.
Okay.
As the prime minister and head boy, and also as the leader of the opposition, which taught me how it's important not only to be critical, because I had been in those shoes myself. It was important to also be responsible in terms of your criticism. That was a important learning that I had in my school days itself.
I think your learning in the school as opposition leader as well as a prime minister probably led you to take up political science as your career itself.
Yeah, that was something I decided in my those days. You have to decide whether you are going to art, science or commerce in 9th grade itself.
That's right.
So
yeah.
I took that decision then that I want to go into social sciences. Initially, wonderful. The desire was to become a civil servant, but later on I realized I would be better off being in the teaching and research profession. And today it's my good luck that more than 70-80 of my students are senior civil servants.
Oh, wonderful. That's great. Anyway, that shows like from an early age, you had this good fortune to take up leadership positions, and I'm sure it would have helped you in later life. Because basically leaders make choices, and it would have definitely helped you to take the right choices at the right time.
Undoubtedly.
Is there any person whom you think would have influenced your leadership style at any point of time?
See, at different stages of life, there are different people who would have inspired you to believe and do what you do.
Right.
I think a very, very abiding influence in my life was that of my father,
okay.
Who had a very, very silent way of leading. I never remember him having scolded me for anything.
Oh my God.
But I never remember not having disappointed him and therefore made sure that I never gave an opportunity for him to evoke a scolding for me. So that was an important influence in my life. And that is something I've tried to follow as I move along. That he was the one who taught me that try and recognize the good in all people. Everybody has a combination of pluses and minuses. It may be a good idea not to focus on the minuses, but to focus on the pluses. And that's something that has always been an important inspiration for me as I went along. Then, of course, my teachers in school, I had an extremely energetic principal in my school who I'm still in touch with today. Tom, I must recall this incident which happened around 2-3 years ago with him. He's still the vice president of a school trust. And he had put me on the board of his school. So I had gone for a school meeting and I was sitting with him in his chamber. And somebody asked him a question, which I was very, very hesitant to ask him. And the question was, sir, when are you going to retire? That was the question that person asked him. When are you going to retire? And I was all ears to hear the answer. And his answer was a great lesson, which just tells you how maybe 40 years ago also he inspired all of us. He said, retire. When did I start working? I have been learning right from the beginning. I never worked, so there is no question of retiring. And that was the way he led us even when he was a school principal. So that is something that I always, that I looked up to him as a leadership model. Later in life, and I, if I were to come more recently, one leader who has really, really inspired me. He was inspiring me right from, he used to inspire me right from my early school days.
Okay.
Because when I was 6 year old, when I was 4 year old, he became the Prime Minister of India. And when I was 6 year old, he passed away. And I'm referring to Lal Bahadur Shastri.
Okay.
3 years back, I was privileged to write a book on Lal Bahadur Shastri. Rupa commissioned me and said, would you like to write a book on Lal Bahadur Shastri? And I jokingly asked them, are you asking me that because we both have the same surname? And he said, no. We know that you have worked on leadership. So would you like to write a book on him? And I agreed. Okay. And I did a year's research, and I have yet to find a more inspiring figure than Lal Bahadur Shastri.
Oh, that's great.
In terms of his humility, in terms of his capacity. And I think leadership is about humility. It's about grace. It's about capacity to take everybody along with you and make people feel that you are not asking them to do something, but they are doing something which they actually wanted to do. And you only provided a direction to them. Lal Bahadur Shastri used to tell people, he wouldn't tell people, will you work with me? No. He used to say, can I work with you?
That's a big thing.
His style used to be, can I work with you? Kya main aapke saath kaam kar sakta hu? Used to be his style. And you see, I'm just imagining when you tell somebody, can I work with you? How is it that the person tells you, no, you cannot work with me? See? And Shastriji never used to say this only in terms of rhetoric or as a formality. He actually implemented this as part of his working style. So he's somebody who has greatly inspired me. And my book on him is full of anecdotes from his life. If I could just share one more.
Yes, sure.
Tom, when he died as Prime Minister in 1966, he had a Fiat car.
Yes, I heard this.
He had a Fiat car. Okay. And believe it or not, Tom, he had bought it on a bank loan. As Prime Minister of India, he had bought a car on a bank loan. And when he died, the bank loan had not been cleared. And his wife insisted on clearing the bank loan through the pension amount she used to get every month, which was drawn from on behalf of Shastriji. Now, this is the type of leadership which truly inspires you and asks you the question, if you can at least be 1% of what these people was, you would be able to touch so many lives in your life.
Absolutely. I wonder where such leaders vanished. I think in the early part of our, post-independence, we had a whole lot of such leaders and that actually built the foundation for this country.
And Tom, this is not just in politics. I think this is my view. Politics reflects society.
Exactly.
So if the leadership has disappeared in politics, it seems to be less in all fields of life. And that's politics is invariably a mirror of what you see in society.
You're perfectly right. Now, I just wanted to ask you, see, sometimes what happens, you get your leadership, takes a turn with some incident. Like, for example, Mahatma Gandhi, because of his experience in the train when he traveled in South Africa, suddenly he got inspired that I should go back to my people to fight this injustice. So is there any incident which you can recall which helped you or changed the way of you approach leadership? If there is any incident you can think of.
Let me share an incident which happened in my younger days. I was given administrative responsibilities at a very young age, even before I had touched 30. And I still remember an incident where I was looking after an institution, an entire institution. Okay. And that institution was doing a lot of social work. So we had people living in that institution who had been brought there by very rich parents who required support to be able to deal with these special children, and also maybe their grown-up children who had important behavioral problems to look after. There was one such boy who was under our charge, and I was told to make sure that he's taken care of properly, and all the funding for that was provided by the institution. And I did that very diligently. 1 month down the line, after I took on this responsibility, the father of that boy landed up there and told me, thank you for this, I'm so honored that you are helping me out and I can focus on my work. We said, it's our duty to do that. And then he gave me a bag. And Tom, this is like that typical leather bag he gave me. I said, what is this? He said, no, I give this every time I come here for my son's upkeep. I opened that bag. And Tom, I'm talking of around 35 years ago. That bag would have had a minimum of 5 lakh rupees.
My God.
And I asked him, give me time to decide whether I should keep, whether I should take it or not. And then I went to the head of the institution and asked him, I've got this bag. What should I do? He said, no, give it back. We are committed to looking after this person. So don't take that back from him.
Okay.
I said, okay. So I called that person and said, look, this bag need not be given. Now onwards, you don't need to give any bag. But I used to do this for everyone, to the person who was there before you each time. And then I realized what had happened, you see, that the person had kept the bag and not given it on to the organization.
Nobody knew about it.
And nobody knew about it. And of course, such things happen. One day somebody comes to know about it and then your name gets into the mud. Then he gave me another bag. I opened that bag. It was those days, Marks and Spencers had not come to India. It was six of the latest Marks and Spencer shirts and pants. I said, who is this for? He said, this is for you. Because I used to get this for the person who was there before you in this position. I closed that bag also and gave it back to him and said, today onwards, you don't need to bring this. Tom, this was my first brush with corruption, which taught me that if I have to take on responsibility positions, I must always be aware that corruption comes to you in very, very innocent ways and makes you feel that this is not corruption. This is normal. This is part of your work. There's nothing wrong in what you're doing. So this taught me, and that has stood me in great stead for the last 30 years, that that what seems to be a deviation from norms may appear before you in very, very innocent and ordinary ways. And you need to be always on your guard to make sure that it does not overtake you. Because once you get the taste of it, you tend to believe that that is what is normal. And that's something I have always, always guarded myself against during the last 30 years.
So you're saying leaders have opportunities to get
leaders have all types of opportunities, but a leader has a choice as to which opportunities he or she would like to take forward.
Exactly.
And a leader has a choice as to whether he or she gets caught in the swamp and you never realize it's a swamp until your head is deep inside the swamp.
That's right.
You believe that you are doing the right thing. And that's why that antenna of caution needs to always be up, so that you always keep in mind, you always ask yourself, is this something you actually should be doing?
Right.
And that's where I remember my father, my teachers, my family, my wife, my children. And I ask myself, would they be okay if I did something like this? You see, tomorrow, if something were to happen, would they be okay if I did something like this? And that has been a great savior for me in terms of the type of decisions that I've had to take in very difficult situations.
I think it's a good lesson for any leader that we should think of whether your parents would have done the same thing at the same position.
Or whether your family, whether you can show your face to your children and your wife tomorrow when such a thing comes into the public domain, that question.
Very nice. Very, very good lesson actually for people in position of leadership. Dr. Shastri, one of the biggest challenges you would have faced in your leadership, especially since you're occupying positions of leadership in educational institutions, you know, we have very big challenge because you handle a large number of people. It's all about people. So can you think of any incident, you know, which challenged you and how you overcame that, which could be of use to our listeners?
I have believed that leadership is always about carrying your team with you.
Right.
Never letting down your team. never letting your team believe that I am not there for them.
Now, very true.
For me,
very
this
true.
Has been the most important virtue.
Very true. Yeah.
And if I could just quote here, Dr. Abdul Kalam. Abdul Kalam talks about his guru.
Right.
Sarabhai. I'm sorry. I'm not getting the name immediately.
Satish Dhawan.
Satish Dhawan. Yeah. He talks about Satish Dhawan. That there was a failure of a satellite once. And Kalam was working in that team and Satish Dhawan was in charge.
Yes.
And when it collapsed, he said, what is this? And they all were to go and announce it in Doordarshan or All India Radio.
Public
and just as they were about to go, Satish Dhawan told all of them, look, Prime Minister has sanctioned the next installment of research work. So go ahead and do the work. You don't need to worry about all these press conferences. I will look after it. And Satish Dhawan goes there and announces, this has been a failure. I take responsibility for this. I led the team. But I promise you, within X period of time, we will be back in the space.
Right.
And as would have it, they launched the satellite after all the testing very soon. And it was a success.
Yep.
And this time, Kalam says he and Satish Dhawan were walking to the press conference. And just as they were about to enter the press conference, Satish Dhawan told Kalam, Kalam, there is an important meeting I have to go for. These press conferences will keep happening. You go and attend the press conference. And Kalam went there and took all the credit for what happened. And Kalam that later on says, this is what my leader taught me, that leadership is about being there in difficult times with your team.
Right.
And allowing your team to savor the goodwill and the accolades when you achieve success.
That's
and
great.
I have found that with people who have led me.
Okay.
In my younger days as a lecturer, my professor, when he got invitations, he used to tell the invitees, look, don't call me, call him. He's much better than I will be. And he used to jokingly tell everybody, now onwards, I will not get invitations because this chap will get invitations now, you see. And he was the one who put me into the circuit by doing that, you see. So he need not have done that. He could have continued to go for invitations he was called for.
Absolutely.
And that is a lesson I have learned from him, that if there's an opportunity to depute a younger colleague, if there's an opportunity to send somebody else on behalf of your organizations, go ahead and do that. You don't need to hog the limelight all the time. You don't deserve the limelight at all. Maybe it is they who deserve the limelight, and let them shine in that limelight. So I've also learned this from my leaders. Whenever I go to inaugurate a program in a school or in a college, and people tell me, come and light the lamp, I would often say, why should I will go there. But I will say, can we call a few senior students and a few senior parents? Because this is their function. This is their function. Can they light the lamp? Can they light the lamp? They will remember it for quite some time that we lit the lamp at our son's or daughter's function. Or they will say, when we were in 10th grade, we lit the lamp of a function in our school. Now, I am a facilitator there.
Absolutely.
I stand behind them and allow them to do that wonderful job, which is so special to them. So for me, I mean, a leadership position gives you an opportunity to do that, you see, gives you an opportunity to share responsibility, you see, gives you an opportunity to allow others to be in the limelight rather than you alone being on the spotlight. So, and I have found that this really works wonders. And subsequently, the way people take ownership for tasks that you give them, it's simply stupendous to watch, actually.
So it's always good to acknowledge the quality of people working around them and accept it and give them the chance and stay back, which will help us to get the team to perform much better than...
Undoubtedly. And Tom, this should never look artificial.
Right.
That I'm doing this in order to gain some more brownie points. You genuinely feel that they are the ones who are doing it. So let's put them in the front.
Wonderful. That's great. Yeah. Now, what do you think is the most important quality of a good leader in a day-to-day handling of the situation?
good leader.
I think you have mentioned in your previous question itself, saying that the ability to understand and accept your team members and give them the opportunity rather than you taking the limelight is one of the great.
A good leader, I think, is an active listener.
Great.
And a good leader makes your team feel
that they have done
that they are wanted, that they are privileged, and that they are special. And this is not through words alone, but through the range of actions that you perform.
Okay.
I've tried something like when I took on the leadership at Jagran Lake City University.
Yeah.
One of the first things I did was I asked the HR team to give me the birth date of every employee of the university. I created a calendar where I had the birthday of every employee of the university.
Okay.
I joined on January 1st. So I started this from January 2nd. Between 8 and 10 in the morning, I will call up a colleague who has a birthday on that day and wish her or wish him on that birthday and tell him or her how much I value them as a part of my organization. By drawing an example, and as I proceeded further, I met these people also before their birthdays. So I was able to share with them that day something very nice I felt about them during the time I have known them. Now, many of them tell me that I made their day. Now, many of them tell me, sir, we are waiting for that call because we knew that that call will come. Many of them tell me, sir, I don't know, when I meet them outside in another situation, sir, I don't know why my birthday is in December. I have to wait for December for your call to come. Now, I genuinely want to wish them on their birthday because they are such valued colleagues of mine. See,
okay.
I feel as the head of the university, it's my job to reach out to each of them when it's a day they, it's a birthday that they celebrate.
Great.
And what greater joy than participating in their joy? What greater joy than being part of their joy? And how much time does it take you to do it? At best, there would be maybe two employees or sometimes three employees in a day who you have to call up. So maximum, it takes you around 10 minutes to do all the three calls. Now, is that too much of time to spare for you and the type of joy it gives you? Forget the joy it gives them.
That's
the
right.
The joy
You're
it gives
right.
you that you were able to wish a colleague on this very special day in their life. Now, I sometimes feel these small things that we do in life is something very important. And when we do it with a sense of genuineness, when we do it with a sense of sincerity, and you're not doing it to any earn any brownie points yourself.
Absolutely.
You're doing it because you sincerely feel that that needs to be done. So I've always tried to find out some way of reaching out to my colleagues and making them feel valued within the system. When somebody writes a good article, send them a message that I read this and I enjoyed this. If they send me an article, don't just reply saying excellent. Read through it, find something important in that, and then reflect on that when discussing with them, which convinces them that he has not just wished us for what we wrote, but he has actually gone through it and is making a comment based on what we have written.
I think what you're doing is not very easy. And many a times, though we attempt, I as a leader try to attempt, but then I myself have failed, especially in this birthday, what you're telling. You start it, for some time you do it, but then you don't continue it.
I am lucky to have a team with me. Yesterday was the end of the month and I had forgotten to update my birthday diary for this month. And the person who works with me, she came up to me and said, sir, you have not given me your diary to update. You see, she's asking me, sir, you have not given me your diary to update. You have to update it for next month. And next week, whole week is a holiday. You will not be able to get it. So give it to me today only. I'll update it for you. So I'm lucky to have such people work with me who keep me updated and make me feel good in front of others. You see.
That's great. I think it's a good thing. And it's a great thing. And one of the lessons, what summary is that you should make your colleagues feel that they are required, they are wanted, they are special, and then the effort will be much better than you try to, you know, push them to do things.
Tom, I've always believed the greatest challenge in leadership, at least in the Indian context, is the hierarchies we create. You see?
Yes.
I've often believed, should people listen to me because of the way I influence them, or should people listen to me because of a position that I hold? I have believed leadership is about influence and not about power.
Correct.
I have believed leadership is not about the position you hold. Today, all those students and colleagues who I interacted with in my earlier two jobs, because fortunately for me in my entire career, I've had only three jobs. First at Bangalore University, then in the Jain Group, and now here. And in my first two jobs, it's by my good fortune that whoever I knew there continue to respond with me. Now,
wonderful.
They need not respond with me because they are not accountable to me in any way today, in a sense. I'm not in any position of power within their organizations. But I would believe it's possibly the influence, the relationship that we developed when we were working together that makes them continue to wish me, I have been this morning responding to various Diwali greetings which I'm getting from colleagues from my earlier two jobs. Now, they need not have remembered to wish me, and I need not remember to wish them, but I do it and they do it. And that bond, I think, is very important, where relationships go beyond the positions that you occupy.
I agree. I think it's a good lesson. Now, it's a question which I ask everyone is, do you really enjoy your position as a leader? Or it is it's a burden. Some people take it as a burden.
I have always enjoyed whichever position I have been in. Right from my starting journey in 1982 as an assistant professor at a university, which I think in some ways was also a leadership position.
Absolutely.
Because on the very first day of my class, at the end of my class, my student came up to me and said, sir, I want to discuss something with you. And it had nothing to do with the subject. It had to do something about his personal life. On my very first day as a lecturer. So that day I realized that people will come to you for advice and they will often ask you advice without your permission also. So right from day one, I have realized that I'm in a profession where people look to you for advice. Now, as I moved along, that advice was on a range of issues, and sometimes it was linked to the position, sometimes it was not linked to the position. And I have, till today, never felt it as a burden. I've never felt it as a burden. Again, this is something that my father taught me.
Okay.
That when you take on a responsibility, look at the joy of what you're doing and look at the goodwill that you are spreading through what you do. And I saw him doing it during his career. I know his colleagues used to keep telling me, that your father has no enemies in the system. Everybody loves your father. Everybody wants to interact with him. So I would say the same about Lal Bahadur Shastri. When he became prime minister, he became prime minister because he had no enemies.
Yes.
Nobody disliked him. Now, I often ask myself the question, in a position of responsibility, can I make everybody feel comfortable dealing with me?
Okay.
Can I make, and which does not mean that you allow people to walk over you. You see, people know very clearly what is negotiable and what is non-negotiable with you. People know very clearly on what you have zero tolerance. But right. Then I think it's important the way you put it across to them. So I have never found leadership to be a burden. In my university, everyone, from a student to a faculty, everyone has access to my mobile number.
Oh.
Everybody has access to my WhatsApp number. And they know that any time they can send me a message. And I have earned a reputation in my career that within half an hour of an email coming to me from anyone, they would receive a response to the email. It may just be a one-liner saying, I'll get back to you before the end of the day if I'm in the middle of a meeting. But I make sure that I get back to them by the end of the day.
Wonderful. It's not easy.
I've always tried to build trust because at the end of the day, I may be very old-fashioned when I say this. At the end of the day, when you occupy a responsible position, you become public property.
I agree.
And when you become public property, there is nothing like private time for you. Even if it is midnight, 11 o'clock, even if it is late night, 11 o'clock, they have a right to ask you something if they feel there is something very urgent, which they need to get in touch with you about. So for me, I think that's a price you pay for agreeing to serve an organization at a very senior level. That your time is public time.
Right.
And those in your organization have a right to that time of yours and have a right. So when people ask me, sir, can I call you after office hours? I say, for me, you can call me 24/7.
Great.
So my friends sometimes wonder, sir, we receive a email reply from you at 11 o'clock at night, at 4 o'clock in the morning, at 6 o'clock in the morning. I said, yes, that's because if I happen to be awake at that point of time, I will respond. And at the end of the day, if you're occupying a position and if people are responsible to you,
yeah,
you are also responsible to them. See?
Absolutely.
It's a two-way street. Responsibility in that sense is a two-way street.
Great. So you do your work as a leader with passion, and then there's nothing like you enjoy or you don't enjoy.
I've always followed the statement, lead with compassion,
okay,
work with passion,
okay,
and achieve with conviction. You see,
excellent.
Passion,
excellent.
Compassion, and conviction are the three things which are the buzzwords for any leader.
The pillars on which you have built up your position. Great. Now, what would be your advice to the youngsters? I'm sure you're advising them on a regular basis since you are a vice chancellor of a university and you have been a professor. So, two important advices to aspiring leaders. What would that be?
Advice number one, dream big. Dream your dream, live your dream, achieve your dream.
Wow.
Because it's not enough to dream your dream.
Right.
You need to dream your dream. You need to live your dream. And at the end of the day, achieve your dream. So this is my first word of counsel to young people who come to meet me. My second counsel to young people who come to meet me is follow your passion. You see. Don't be influenced by the crowd around you in terms of what that crowd wants to do. Follow your passion.
Okay.
Follow your passion. We all are passionate about something, and that what you are passionate about may not be what others are passionate about, but that doesn't make a difference. Follow your passion. Listen to advice, but do what you think is the best after listening to all your advice. Never give up your commitment to your passion.
Okay.
That would be my second advice to the younger generation today. And if you combine these two, I think success is then at your doorstep. success not in terms of achievement, success not in terms of earning money, success not in terms of positions and glory, but success in terms of self-satisfaction.
Great.
Success in terms of when you put your head on the pillow at the end of the day,
you feel good.
Get to sleep very quickly because there is nothing serious you're worrying about because you have followed your passion.
Wonderful. I think it's a great advice to the youngsters because not many, at least the parents don't advise like this. So at least as a teacher, I'm sure this will help many youngsters. Because if you follow your dream and follow your passion, I think success, it will lead to success.
And also I could add a third point, Tom.
Sure.
Life is not a 50-meter race, but a 10-kilometer marathon.
Right.
I always advise young people, don't expect instant success.
Correct. That's what we want now.
Race. It's not a sudden burst of energy and dash. It is a 10-kilometer marathon, and your sustainability, your patience, your durability, and your energy at the end is what is most important.
Right. Very nice, Dr. Shastri. It has been very wonderful listening to you, and I'm sure your ideas, your thoughts, your passion will definitely help our listeners, and wish you all the best. And
I compliment you for this endeavor you have started, and I'm sure this is touching the lives of thousands and thousands of people and transforming the way they look at life and the world. And my congratulations to you and Global TV for this wonderful act of service that you are all involved in. And may the numbers like you grow, and may they continue to spread the sunshine of wisdom and knowledge across the world.
Thank you so much, and wishing you all the best once again.